Hi, everyone. My name is Nima Kalantari. I'm from Texas A&M University. I'm the session chair of Images and Textures, which is the last paper session of EGSR. We have two excellent papers, one on texture synthesis and one on neural face swapping. So before we get to the talks, I wanted to remind you to please ask questions in Rocket Chat during the talk. This is different from physical conferences. So during the talk, whenever you have a question, please type into Rocket Chat so I can ask the authors after the talk. All right, let's get to the first talk. The title of this paper is Semi-Procedural Textures Using Point Process Texture Basis Functions. And the authors are Pascal Gale, Remy Allegre, Jean-Michel Dischler, Bedrich Benez, and Eric Gallin. Pascal is a PhD student at the University of Strasbourg and is going to present the paper. Let's hear the talk now.
Hi, everyone. I'm happy to be able to present our new model of procedural textures. Plan is straightforward. We will present our new model of procedural structures, how to estimate its parameters by example, and how to synthesize with it. First, look at taxonomy of textures. Left, you have noise textures, kind of Gaussian ones, and the more you go to the right, the more you add structures inside, until near regular, regular, and then non-homogeneous ones. Stochastic structure one are really difficult to synthesize, and there is a gap between noise by example and by example texture synthesis. All methods fail at synthesizing them because they require stationarity and fail to preserve structures. Sparse convolution noise, local random phase noise, self-tuning texture optimization, and even deep learning, such as adversarial expansion. So how to handle them? Our approach is rethinking the texture model to think of what is a texture, what is a structure, and looking for kind of unification of texture representations and synthesis methods. We propose a novel texture representation where structure is procedural and details are data-driven. Generated textures have procedural properties, infinity, no repetition, self-consistency, and genericity. The structure can be edited using parameters. Morphic is implicitly obtained by interpreting these parameters, and the data-driven details guarantee a good visual match with the exemplar. In this first part, we are going to explain our PPTBF model, which stands for Point Process Texture Basis Functions. It deals with the modelization of stochastic structures. Let's start by an overview. Natural textures can be seen as embedding special stochastic structures such as cells, cracks, grains, scratches, spots, stains, or waves, and they all share common characteristics. The first characteristic is that basic elements are distributed in space. For cells, it's easy to see. We model the cell's centroid as a feature point xi, and mathematically, it's just a sum of Dirac impulse at each fixture point. The second common characteristic is that basic elements can be either localized in regions or can be contained in overlapping regions like for mold or rust paint. The function is just translated on each fixture point xi. It's mathematically just a convolution with the point process and window function. The third characteristic is the local visual patterns. And these features are constrained into the window function support, kind of 2D footprint. So mathematically, it's just a convolution with a point process and the product of the window function and the feature function. So here is a resume. As the point process is discrete, the final sum is just a sum of a feature function multiplied by a window function at each feature point of the point process. This is the common sparse convolution of previous noise model. So our PPTBF model can be seen as a generalization of previous noise models. Also for Kilting and Graphcoff models, the point process can be seen as the regular or random underlying grid. The feature function is the exemplar itself, and the window function is a smart function that tessellates the domain with a mean cut. Finally, if we look at ways artists are designing appearance on substance designers, we can see that they have two parts, a material part of the node graph, and usually they start by a structure map that contains here just a fish scale that is then distributed in space, as in our model. Now we are going to look at one possible instantiation of the PPTVF metamodel. We explain our choices to manage non-uniform procedural point distributions, such as images below. We can distinguish five types of point process. First, the Poisson is to model pure randomness. Second, Cox point process is a doubly stochastic point process that is used to create some clusters and non-uniformity. Third is the Gibbs point process that is used to model interactions among points such as attraction and repulsion. Arbitrary point process are too complex for us, so we don't use it. And we also add in our model a randomness parameter that can be relaxed to be able to simulate near regular to regular distributions. So we rely on prototile that tile the 2D space, R2 space. So we are just using non-uniform and irregular tiling, and then inside we draw one point randomly. Okay, like this. For point process, we use square cells with constant area. For Cox point process, to make a cluster, we do random tessellation of R2 with varying size. Gibbs point process, we add an iterative load algorithm to create some relaxation. For the window function, the goal is to manage non-overlapping and overlapping windows. So our generic window function will be a weighted sum of collections of these two families with a Gaussian profiles. In the last line of the formulae, there is a clamp to be sure that the support is finite. What is interesting with this generic window function is that if you combine the two with blending and then use threshold, the same PPTVF can generate different kinds of topologies. So first, the window function overlapping, it's just a Gaussian with an isotropic distance LP norm. So we just translate the window, the Gaussian, onto each point process. For the cellular window, we rely on Vorlei noise to build some Voronoi cells, but we inverse the formula to have zero on borders, to have better control for threshold. And we add an anisotropy parameter that enables us to have smooth morphing between the polygonal Voronoi cell shapes and the tessellation cell shapes coming from the underlying tessellation used for the point process. We also add modelization of curved cell shapes by using Bezier curves. In fact, we use the points of the polygonal Voronoi cells as control points, so we have a coefficient to control the smoothness. Now we are going to look at the feature function to manage local patterns such as stripes, grains, dots, or stains. Our feature function is a combination of anisotropic Gabor kernels. This type of kernels are Gaussians modulated by sinusoidal function. You can see on the right this type of function. We add some parameters to be able to control more parameters like the frequency of oscillations, the orientation, curliness, thickness, anisotropy, their decay, the number of kernels we sum, and we can also inverse the phase to inverse the patterns. But the most important is the mixture model. This is how we combine these Gabor kernels. So the feature function could be constant, it could be a sum of Gabor, or a weighted sum with a negative and positive one, mean that will create some Voronoi, and priority to do some bombing. We also add a correlations parameters so that the kernel positions are drawn closer to the feature points of the window function. This reduces the randomness and start to build higher structural organizations, as you can see on the bottom left, different types of textures. Finally, to look more realistic, we also add deformations with the help of turbulence, classical parameters like gain and frequency. Here is the complete list of PPTVF parameters that we have used to model stochastic structures. To evaluate our PPTVF model of procedural structures, we have segmented a database of 150 textures plus 20 materials scanned in procedural PBR, and check if we are able to reproduce the structures. For each image, we have four colons. From left to right, the input image, the segmented binary image, our PPTBF, and its thresholded version. So in fact, you have to look at the second and the fourth colon to compare the input and the, our procedural structures. Look at the second and fourth colon. You see that it's really close. One nice property of the PPTBF model is that we can make some transitions between visual patterns. It is just metamorphosis of distance functions. So we can create nice patterns like this. Here is the second part of the talk that deals with bare example parameters estimation of our procedural structures. So given an input exemplar, we ask the user to provide a segmented input. And the question is how to find closest PPTBF whose thresholded version looks similar to input X structure. So here is an example. So we can see that the input and our closest structures cannot be compared pixel by pixel. This is more kind of semantic. So we need a perceptual matrix of similarity. To do that, we propose this solution. We first generate a database of PPTBF by spanning its space of parameters. Then we threshold this database to have binary images. We then compute feature vectors based on computer vision descriptors and make a new database. And we are going to work on these feature vectors by using a similarity matrix like the L2 norm. And we'll be able to compare distance between feature vectors. So here is the first step. We need to build a database of PPTBF by sampling the parameter space. Recall that we have kind of 30 parameters, so a regular sampling will generate billions of images, which is not tractable. So the idea is to make an empirical non-regular sampling by avoiding redundancy among images and large gaps between visual structures. So how we have done that? We have used our real-time GPU visualizers and try to remove values that doesn't influence the final appearance. And we also do that manually by removing images. The second step consists by thresholding the previous PPTBF database. We are going to obtain some binary images and we decided to create three banks of images according to threshold value, which is the ratio between white and black pixels. So we have 80%, 50%, and 20%. And then when we generate the images, we only keep the ones that are not too close with an L2 norm. And we end with 450 kilo images. So now we are going to generate feature vectors from binary images. We are looking for descriptors that encode and embed structure of images. So we rely on the article UNL 2018 from Bo to CNN, 2 decades of texture representation for texture classification. We have selected certain types of descriptors like the multiscale LBP, local binary patterns, the Gabor binary patterns. These descriptors try to find some basic elements inside images, like kind of T-junction, edges, lines, circles. There is also the histogram of Gabor filters. And CNN-based, like the VGG19, I tried the last layer features, but also the third one that, as you can see in images, contains some structures. In our test, we have seen that there are no better descriptors than the others. Depends on the shape of the input textures. So we need for more refinement. Now here is our complete pipeline. Given a segmented input, we ask the feature vectors database which are the closest one with an automatic nearest neighbor search with brute force or flying library to accelerate. Based on these candidates, we are going to refine a round by Monte Carlo sampling and find new PVTVF and threshold inversion. Then the users will select the better one for him and finish with manual editing. So here is the video showing our pipeline. We also propose a creative AI approach by exploring the space of structure. So for this, I use a machine learning techniques with the Gaussian process, which is inspired by the article Gaussian Material Synthesis from TOG 2018 Zollner-Ferrer. So the idea is that when we have our nearest neighbors candidate, we can embed them in a low-dimensional 2D space with a GPLVM latent variable model, which is a nonlinear dimensionality reduction technique. Bottom left of the image, you have this 2D map, which is the latent space, and we have projected in blue points our nearest neighbors candidates. And the ability of Gaussian process is that in between you can make interpolation and new predictions. So in the image, you have the input exemplars, and you can navigate into the 2D space and make new predictions and on-the-fly procedural rendering. So here is the last part of the talk about our model of semi-procedural textures. Recall from beginning, we have an input exemplar. We ask the user to give a segmented input. We find the closest procedural PPTBF that looks like the exemplars, threshold it, and as we are going to see, it will guide the synthesis based on an extension of parallel control texture synthesis, appearance space synthesis, instant texture by numbers, and proxy guided. So we have this model of procedural structures, which we showed this. We have seen that we can edit and make some transition from the structure, and now we use that for synthesis. So we are going to synthesize some guidance maps on the fly, directly from the input, distance map and label map. And also for the output, we will generate on the fly a new distance map and a new label map. And it will be applied for color texture synthesis, but also for material. We make also another extension to the algorithm, the possibility to relax some constraints on the border of the structures. So on the left, you have an input exemplars. On the bottom, you have PPTBF, that is kind of square, and you have a slider to choose if you want full guided synthesis, or you can re-inject the borders from the input. Okay, so here is a video example. Now let's talk about on-the-fly guidance map synthesis. So if your input exemplars contains many colors, in the synthesis, colors will be blended. So the solution is to use a label map, and then it will work. So the idea is to extend our PPTBF so as to draw a label ID at runtime randomly for each of our feature points, the point of our point process. So it's totally free and on the fly. So we have done for each image of our database. Now some results to validate our models. So the idea again is to use our database of 150 textures plus materials to see if our structure model is able to reproduce the structure of the exemplars and if the data driven part is able to synchronize and reproduce the details of colors and materials. So what we have done is we have compared to 10 other methods, state of the art. So we provide a GPU synthesizer that works by drag and drop of a color exemplar with some given files. You can test to reproduce our results. You have the input exemplar and here we have doubled the size, but we have not constrained. So here some details, some cells, here some dots, overlapping window, here some dots, some lines, here some maps, spread maps, again some maps with noise. So another application would be, donc, you can also do transitions. Here you modify the structure and resynchronize the colors by that gradient-driven optimization. You can also do material synthesis because it's the same algorithm and you can make transitions. Last year we also tried terrain synthesis, but we choose four types of ground and try to make big tiles. Application, we have appearance transfer. Here the material, so they keep your structure but we modify the appearance. So you take an exemplar, you extract its PPTBF, you make addition, and then now you can change the color exemplar. Same things, but here you modify the structure but you keep the okay, so you can change the shape. Here it works at real time. So our contributions is a new model of procedural stochastic structures, a model of semi-procedural textures, a database of segmented exemplars, a database of synthesis results, plus raw source code. Okay, thank you for attention. If you have any questions, don't hesitate.
Okay, very nice talk. Thanks for the presentation. So I'm waiting for questions on the Rocket Chat. Still, we don't have, they will come in as people watch the video. So I'll start with a question on my own. Can you comment on the performance of the system, the timings?
Yes, for the structural model, it's very fast. It's real-time or interactive. You can do some kind of 512 square images in a few milliseconds. But the most important is the data-driven. So it depends on the user options, but you can do it live, as you have seen maybe in some part of the video. The key point, if you really want to keep the grain of the image, the high frequency, you need to do a smart initialization stage, which is a little longer, a few seconds, because it is not yet accelerated on GPU, but it will be soon. It's parallelizable. So it could be evaluated on the fly at real time. You could interact with an environment with time or music and change the appearance.
Okay, cool. We still don't have any questions, so I'll ask another question. So the guidance map, based on my understanding, you generated you assigned the colors randomly, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so how does the system work if your textures is highly regular and you have different colors?
Yes, okay, so this is a limitation that I don't forget to show in the video. Alors, actually, we don't handle this because we wanted to work on stochastic textures, but it can be done if, as I said before, at the smart initialization stage, if I duplicate the label map of the input, and instead of doing on-the-fly drawing labels, I can draw in this tiled input, but see, it's not in the model because the idea is we don't want only to reproduce the texture, we want to take control. So we want to change the shape so there is no more bijections between the two shapes. So it's very, very difficult to handle this kind of structure in the labels.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And one more question, and I think we'll go to the next talk after this question. So you interpolate basically the parameters to do texture interpolation from one to another. Did you experience any problem? You're linearly interpolating the parameters, right?
Yes.
My question is, did you experience any problems for the intermediate values, like mismatching the parameters or a certain combination won't generate good results? Did you experience any problem with that?
Right, yes. In fact, actually, what we do, we cannot mix different types of distributions because underlying there is some kind of tiling and only certain combinations can work, actually. I think we could change that, but usually it's just a metamorphosis of distance field. Normally it's okay, but usually it's better to have the same tiling but change the jittering to make some randomness in between.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay.
So we'll go to the next talk. The title of the paper